you all for joining us. We're here with Sam Esmail, Marti Noxon, Nina Jacobson, John Ridley, Julian Fellows, Melissa Rosenberg, and I'm your host, Lacey Rose. And I think we'll jump right into this. So between the six of you, you've touched on themes including suicide, rape, murder, sexism, classism, addiction, mental illness. As storytellers, when was the last time you guys were genuinely scared to tell a story?
That list, I thought you were just talking about Downton. Do you get scared to tell it? I mean, I think you work within a kind of world. Every show operates within a world that is established. And within that world, things are done in a certain way, just as in a musical comedy, people sing. And you have a sort of style. I mean, in the Downton style was that terrible things happened to them, but you never saw anything. Mm-hmm. You never saw people being raped or murdered or any of the other terrible things that happened. But we were interested in going into the results in their emotional well-being and all of that stuff. But there was nothing graphic. On the other hand, I'd be perfectly happy to write a completely different show that had a different language and everyone was cutting each other up, you know, throughout. I think it's just, it's the style of the show, and then you take the story into that style, really. I don't think you would be nervous unless the story was completely incompatible with the show.
But you've had people, you know, die on the show, and I imagine there is a panic of, oh gosh, how is the audience going to respond to this?
Well, of course, the death of Matthew goes down as one of the great television crimes of our day.
I'll never forgive you for that. Well,
and the letters I got. I mean,
did you get my letter?
I will never watch anything ever again with your name on it.
Well, it was a double death season, too. I mean, it was, you know, it wasn't just
it was
one death.
It was relieved. There's nothing you can do. You can't get someone to have a facsimile of his head and wear it,
fair
you
enough.
Know. So you just have to tough it through.
Should I ring for more tea?
Are you always so cool and collected? I do hope so.
I'm not sure what you mean.
Well, only that your words have made my heart pound at such a rate, I'm surprised you can't hear it. I'm hot, I'm cold, I can barely breathe, and it's all because of you.
I must say, you carry it off rather well.
Thanks.
Of course, the lovely thing is that the audience believes in the show to such an extent that they assume a character only dies because you've decided to kill them, mm-hmm. yeah. not because they're desperate to get off and do a show on Broadway, you know, which is the real truth.
I think, you know, for me, what was made me nervous was how the audience is going to accept it, whether they will or not. Mm-hmm. And I was mm-hmm. dealing with a lot of different issues of rape, abortion, interracial relationships,
easy
feminism,
topics.
All this stuff. And the one I thought was really going to get the most flack was the abortion mm-hmm. Story. Mm-hmm. The one that actually got the most, much to my horror and disappointment, was the interracial relationship.
Can you punch through a wall? Can you stop a moving car?
A slow-moving car.
Can you fly?
It's more like jumping and then falling.
Okay. There's you, me, the big green dude and his crew. You think there's more of our kind out there?
I got put on a hate site, actually, a little Nazi
really?
Hate site, and it was like, it was terrifying.
Wow.
You know, they had a picture of me taken from something, and Brian Michael Bendis, who wrote the comic book, with a Jewish star on it, I was like, of all of the things, that didn't really occur to me that was going to mm-hmm. be the thing. So that was scary. I was scared in that moment, and I did not, at that moment, I understood why actors who are so much in front of a camera are nervous.
I did have one very interesting thing, actually, and then I'll shut up. But when we did have the rape story, when Anna the maid was raped, a woman said to me, there's one thing I don't understand, because what they used to do is repeat last week's show on Sunday afternoon and then show that week, you know, in the evening. And she said, I watched that program on Sunday and then I watched it again on Sunday afternoon the following week, and you'd re-edited it. I said, what do you mean? She said, well, you'd taken out all the graphic stuff out of the rape. Mm. And I said, it was in your head. There was no change in the edit at all. But that was rather fascinating, that she was so horrified by the story that she'd actually elaborated it in her brain to something that was almost unacceptable.
Sure. John, were there different themes, different storylines that you were a little skittish about doing, ultimately felt it was important to include in the series?
Not so much the stories itself. There was a moment
where, and I don't keep a lot of people at all close to me. I don't stay in touch with people, but there's somebody. I just don't.
Good to know.
Yeah. So it was nice knowing y'all. And best of luck with your career.
Yeah, it's great, so it's safe to have lunch with you. Yeah.
Absolutely, your secrets are safe with you. It's not going anywhere. Somebody, so obviously it was somebody who was kind of close to me, had said about a storyline, you know, I know that you took my, something that happened to me and put it in there. And I had actually forgotten that somebody had shared something with me. So there, it was a reminder that when I get nervous, it's not so much about how the audience will take it, because, you know, things that you, like you say, that you don't even think about, you know, there's going to be an army of people who are going to slap you up on an internet, but it was that sort of reminder that there are some things, you know, Chris McQuarrie said to me one time, he said, you know, being a writer is hurting the people that you know to impress a bunch of people you're never going to meet. Huh. Mm-hmm. And so that was just sort of a reminder that it's it's not so much about the people that you're never going to meet, but that every once in a while, there's stuff that you didn't intend to steal, you didn't intend to take. Mm-hmm. My life is incredibly narrow, so it's the kinds of people that you meet casually are important to you and share something, and somewhere in the back of your mind, you know, it's almost like, you know, pilfering a song. You thought you wrote it, but actually it was somebody else's life.
Sure, sure. So a lot of, you guys are often drawing from personal experience in these shows, whether you are doing it sort of consciously or subconsciously. I'm curious sort of what were those sort of moments where you realized, wow, this is hitting really close to home?
I mean, my show, because I grew up with that community, like, you know, most of my friends were coders, some were hackers, and I even tried to dabble in it. I just ripped a lot of their characteristics off and just put them in my characters. And it got eerie a lot of times. And also, there's a fine line there, because there are real hackers out there. And if you don't do that respectfully, they could retaliate.
Are you afraid of that? That would scare
absolutely.
Me almost more than anything else.
Absolutely.
Oh, my God, yeah. Every day. And, but so far, knock on wood, they've actually liked the show.
I'm not saying anything new. We all know why we do this, not because Hunger Games books makes us happy, but because we want to be sedated. Because it's painful not to pretend. Because we're cowards. Society.
But there's also pieces to the show, whether it's the morphine piece, whether it's the social anxiety pieces. Those are pieces that are drawn from personal experience. Does that make it sort of easier or harder in the storytelling process for
that,
you?
The thing that I'm scared about is, are we showing it in an authentic way? Mm-hmm. Are people going to, is it going to land with people, or is it going to feel exploitive? Mm-hmm. But I think it's always important to bring up, I mean, if you're not saying something, then what's the point? You know what I mean? If you're not going to do that so I was basically scared every episode, because I think every episode we tried to say something about something, and I was just nervous that people were going to take it the wrong way, or wasn't, or we didn't do our jobs in articulating our point well enough. But I always loved taking the risk anyway, you know?
Sure. What you have to remember is that every single story has happened to an enormous number of people. Mm. They don't have to know you that you've ripped it off. There's a limited number of human experiences.
Yeah.
And I think you do worry, particularly with serious stuff, that you are handling it with sufficient reverence. I mean, when Sybil died in childbirth in Downton, I had some letters after that really made me cry. I mean, people writing about their own daughters dying, and think, oh, blimey. And you just think, I hope somehow this has been useful and not hurtful way you've depicted it, really.
I was going to say, I had a friend who once said to me, you should run toward the things that scare you. And
so what were they? I mean, in the case of your series?
Well, I would say there's been a sort of a sea change in my work in general, in that the more personal, the more universal it's become. So unless I feel a certain level of anxiety about, like, this is a little close to the bone, I kind of feel like I'm not doing it right anymore. Right. Like, and my work narrows in that way, no matter whether it's genre or, you know, in Unreal, being so openly feminist, just being so overtly, like, this show is about women who are not necessarily likable doing a job that is despicable, and we are not going to be afraid of that. Like, we were terrified, but we're not going to pull our punches, and we're not going to treat these characters any differently than we would their male counterparts.
Without further ado, your suitor, Adam Cromwell.
Okay, come on, let's go, people. Protect the wifeys, Anna and Grace, and starve our villain, Brittany, until she is mean like a pit bull. I want to pickle the rest of them, okay? You get cash bonuses for nudity, 911 calls, cat fights, all right? Have a good show, everybody.
Sarah wrote this incredible line. I always, when I read it, I thought, I never would have thought of that. It's when Shiri's character says to Constance, you know, I love you, in the finale. And boy, did I was like, that's genius, because it is all kinds of love. Mm-hmm. It's every kind of love. It's the love that wants to kill you. Mm-hmm. You know? Uh-huh. And I think that, like you said, if you're not saying something, I've really grown tired of something that is clever and signifies nothing. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. and this whole thing about likability, it's like, I really cannot stand that. Because honestly, if you're just trying to portray a genuine person, I mean, we all have unlikable, you know what I mean? And I mean, you know, if you look at like these old movies, you know, these other TV shows that were, you can see that they're totally catering to you to love that person, but because the person doesn't exist. I mean, there's not a person that exists that doesn't have unlikable traits. So it's, I always hate that conversation. It's really like kind of like a cancer in the
writers. I was told in not too long ago that if I had been more agreeable and taken more notes, that the character would have been more likable and the show would have done better. And I was like,
who told you that?
I mean, what type of name?
Yeah,
what
somebody in a suit.
Okay. That's not as specific.
Take your Peabody and bash.
But no, I mean, those kind of notes that you get, and those come up all the time. I mean, have you? Who else has sort of experienced the thing that just sort of really hits you, and you just want to scream?
Everyone
as a result.
At this table.
Yeah, absolutely.
You must have. But
surprisingly, I mean, with OJ. Remarkably, we got notes to push it from FX, to go for it, to make sure they were very supportive of us taking risks in a way that was remarkable.
Good morning, Miss Clark. I think.
I was scared of taking on OJ overall as a white person, knowing that this is a polarizing case and that, you know, we made every effort to have an inclusive team, but ultimately the people who began the project. He started with a bunch of white people, and we know that the case means different things to different people. And so that was much scarier to me than, say, what we were talking about with episode 6, the Marsha episode, taking on issues of feminism and sexism in the workplace. Like, when you know it, it feels easier and safer, and you can go for it. It's actually more scary, I think, when you know that you're a bit outside of your own experience, and how do you get that right, and how do you make sure that you're addressing complicated subjects that you know are divisive in a way that feels provocative, honest, but also, you know, self-aware.
Mm-hmm. John, you've said, you know, your first season obviously dealt more with racial politics, which hit closer to home for you personally. And then the second season, which was more about the sort of case of sexual assault. Mm-hmm. How did that sort of impact your storytelling process?
Well, Michael McDonald, the other producer, myself, we kind of engineered it backwards. We really wanted to look at the things that we didn't talk about in the first season, which was a lot more about orientation, about socioeconomic issues, about education, about family. Our first year, you know, all the families were just imploding. And this year, we really wanted to have strong family units. And then it was more about the inciting incident, which originally... There was obviously a lot, there's probably never going to be enough, but a lot of conversations about sexual assault on campuses. Mm-hmm. And that's where we started to go. And quite literally, I mean, truly in the 11th hour, Sunday night at 11 o'clock, Michael and I had a conversation, and we felt like what we were doing was strong, sort of similar to what you're saying, that we're going to go into something and have maybe a little bit of a predisposition about things or even a distance about things because we're to guys. Mm-hmm. And I think we were a little nervous about that, but also nervous about, are we yet another male voice going into a subject matter? I don't want to say better suited by women, as though men or women or black or white can't do things, but are we, you know, are we just one more additional voice mm-hmm. in a lot of very adept voices trying to talk about something? And we started to think about, we'd actually read a few stories about male peer-to-peer sexual assault. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. it really did. For a moment, I called Michael. I said, do you think we should go down this road? And he thought about it. I said, I got to call you back. And I think we could just feel our heads sort of turning. And we delayed our pitch to ABC by a couple of days. Huh. And we went in. And the studio, you kind of could feel them go like this. And there was a moment where everybody was, they couldn't wrap their heads around it. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, honestly, not like this was an epiphany. All of a sudden, we were, you know, these really great people doing this. But this moment of, if we're having trouble getting it, but it's happening, maybe this is something that we should be talking about.
There are pictures of your son engaged in lewd behavior. What he was doing in public.
What he was doing?
You asked you us mean what to was look done into to him? This. And
no, what
we
was
did.
Done to him?
We
My
did.
Son was raped.
You need to be careful with that.
If somebody messed him up, they touched him, that is rape.
You need to be very careful with that word.
For all the times that studios or networks or people in suits that we say, you know, they don't support. You know, ABC was amazingly supportive in a subject matter that we certainly want to be sensitive to,
sure.
But if you're not provocative, if you're not really provoking thought, conversation, debate, then you're not servicing in some way. And they were very encouraging to be provocative mm-hmm. with the subject matter. So it was... I was, you know, it's funny because everybody was going around the table. I'm like, I'm not nervous about anything. Why am I nervous? But I look back on it and it was very nerve-wracking because you want to be honorific. You don't want to be delicate. You want people to think. You want people to talk. But you also want them coming away realizing that if we can't solve the issue on a show, then we're certainly, none of us are doing enough to solve it in real life.
Right, right.
I think that's interesting. And I'm sure it was a very good decision. But... I don't think writers can be held back by the fact that I can't deal with rape because I'm not a woman. No. I can't deal with anti-Semitism because I'm not Jewish. I can't deal with racism because I'm not black. None of us would be able to write anything. We all have to write stuff.
Sure.
We write characters who are not our own sex. We must, because that's what we're doing. And I think, of course, in a way, you think, I hope I'm being faithful to this. I hope I'm not being offensive. I hope I've got the right elements of this. But to some extent, it's an act of faith when you write. You just have
sure.
to jump in.
But are
it
you
wasn't,
better
it wasn't
at
so much for me holding back. It was, what else are we pushing forward?
Right.
There were any number... I mean, look, it's... The thing is, we talk about murder all the time. We talk about robbery. We talk about hacking. But statistically speaking, you know, sexual assault, it affects a huge amount of the population. So we're not dealing with it commiserate to the other crimes that we talk about.
Mm-hmm. Right.
For us, mm-hmm. it wasn't just, oh, let's not do it because we're guys. But if we are going to talk about it, and if we are going to try to add yet one more voice to the culture, could we take that extra 2 days and say, is there something else that is not being talked about or making us even more nervous or making us go and do more homework or talk to more people to make sure that we're doing it? I'm not saying, well, I don't want you talking about black people because you're white, or I don't ever want to see you talk about dudes. It's that kind of thing.
I never talk about dudes.
I don't.
I
agreed
vaginas,
to come here
so
today is because I heard that you were talking about dudes somewhere.
Are you better? I mean, there is a question of, are you better at writing what you know? I mean, this came up, you know, over the course of this roundtable series this year, and it came up last year. You know, we've cited the Lee Daniels comment about how I haven't even said it yet.
Lee Daniels, but if there's anybody who's going to comment, he's the he's a vocal
individual.
And his
point was that it made him uncomfortable, and he found it almost insulting when white people tried to write for black people, and that extends beyond that. That's, you know, men writing for women, women writing for men. I mean, do you feel like you are better writing for what you know? And is it, in fact, offensive? Because you're not getting as authentic an experience when somebody else is writing for
I think you.
You Welcome
you,
to
you.
Being a woman, sorry.
Well, I mean, I think you write what you know, but you can I think you write what you really want to know. Like, if you have that genuine curiosity to know that culture or that whatever it is, that race, that orientation, if you have that real genuine curiosity about that, I think that could, you know, that could create something amazing.
Well, otherwise, we'd have no period drama. We'd have no
I think the stories about writers, and ultimately you're writing
about people, about the human experience. So it's like people have asked, you know, what's the trick to writing a female superhero? And as well, you don't write a female superhero.
You write a superhero.
Right. You write a character, you know.
Yep.
And now, certainly, she's informed by her gender, and as all other characters are informed by their religion or race, but they are not defined by it. And I think that's the...
I mean, the primordial stuff. We all know what it is to be heartbroken. We all know what it is to be grief-stricken. We all know what it is to be incredibly happy, I hope. and you, of course, you draw on that.
Yes.
But I think you have to believe that if you're fascinated by a circumstance, by a particular people, you are entitled to tell a story about them. I mean, otherwise, none of us would get anywhere.
I think when you get into problems when it's you don't have a curiosity and you're doing it for, it's like homework to you. Oh, we need to have a diverse cast.
Yeah.
So let's just make that person black or that person a woman. And and if you're just kind of, if that's the way you're treating it, if you don't really have that curiosity about getting into that world, then I think that's what those comments.
You also can't write worrying what the internet's going to think, you know? And there's too much now, I think.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Though I think there's so much, you know, people are already second-guessing, you know, the results before they're even into the process. And you're right. It's like if you have a curiosity and you genuinely drawn to something, the worry about... I had this sort of, like, moment, I don't know how long ago, when I realized that none of the showrunners that I respect the most are well liked by everybody. They're just not well liked by everybody. Everybody will talk trash about every showrunner and every filmmaker that I have the most respect for because they're not afraid to put stuff out there and make people angry. And when I was finally at the place where I was like, maybe I can pretend I don't care, you know, things, you know, I found my output changed dramatically. You cannot live hoping that you're not gonna offend people. You should live hoping you are going to offend people because then you're doing something.
And causing conversation and debate and inspiring all of that. I'm curious with you, Melissa. You talked about crafting this female superhero without sort of thinking about it in those terms. But I imagine in doing so, you were sort of trying to avoid the tried and true tropes that come with that others have explored before you with limited degrees of success.
Well, we have several rules going in I felt very strongly about. One, she was never going to play the honeypot. I mean, she was never going to put on the tight bandage dress and heels and go and seduce the guy she needs information. That was just never going to happen. It's never going to happen because it's not in her character to do that, and it's never going to happen because every single female cop on the air ever been on TV or the air, that's the first thing that's the go-to.
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
And she's never going to go to the strip club.
Mm-hmm.
And that got pitched a lot. You know? It's like, no, we're still not going to the strip club.
We're not doing that.
Maybe he should put on the heels.
Make it
very contemporary.
Very. So there's those sort of things. I also I didn't feel like I need to hear the word bitch. You know, because I was just like, oh, you bitch. It's like it's just sort of a go-to. And I just didn't feel the need to hear it, so I didn't use it but a couple of times.
You know what's also great? You don't talk about female power in the show. It just is. I mean, sometimes...
We did it once or twice. I think Trish says something to the effect of, man, what a problem. I can't remember what it was, but that's your character.
Yeah.
Nina and Melissa, you've both worked on these blockbuster film franchises, an area where there are very few women in prominent roles. What challenges did you face that you perhaps wouldn't have if you were men?
Well, I don't talk about the internet. That's where I got my first lesson man, you take your life into your own hands if you offend if you don't do well by a teenage girl. These girls, it's scary. And on any given day of the week, you can go anywhere online and find out that my hands should be cut off. I've destroyed the Twilight series. As well, you know.
I had that at the end. I had, if Edith Crawley isn't happy on the last night of Downton, Julian Fellows had better sleep with one eye open.
Very, very intense.
They're so weird, all that, though.
Nina, were there moments where the experiences may be different if you were a man?
Well, I definitely think it's very different. I mean, I think in general, men can and frequently do fail up, and women can and do frequently succeed down. And you're just aware of the fact that as a girl, you can't screw up. Like, one screw up and you're in jail, whereas there are countless male executives, writers, directors who get so many chances. And the ability to fail is like an essential part of creativity. All of the most successful people have countless failures, and that's not held against you. Mm-hmm. And yet that is, I think, as a woman, you always feel like that you make that one mistake and you're done. Or maybe you don't even make that mistake and suddenly you're done anyway.
Right.
and there's so many men who you'll say, there is not a female equivalent of that guy anywhere. The person you're like, how does that person have that job still? Or how does that person get hired over and over and over again when there are so many women directors that I know for whom those opportunities are just not there. Yeah. So I think there is an enormous difference on the one hand. But on the other hand, I think that there's a certain power to receptivity that I think sometimes comes more readily to women that is an enormous strength and that sometimes almost makes it easier because you don't feel always that to win, you have to end up on top. And the directors, male or female, and writers who I respect most, they have like a certainty and a conviction with a receptivity. Mm-hmm. And yet that receptivity sometimes, I think, in the sort of horn-locking alpha battles is the first thing to go.
Yeah. It's interesting. Are there doors that you guys feel are still not open to you, types of projects that you believe you sort of wouldn't be entrusted with?
Everything. I got a litany of things that people entrusted me with.
But the middle of the road blockbuster is something you.
That's because you
said.
Never call back.
I know. I see it. Spielberg doesn't want God.
But you've sort of mentioned that you wouldn't be sort of handed a middle of the road blockbuster as willingly and as easily as you would have been as a white dude.
No, and I believe that. I mean, look, I don't want to expand this conversation too far beyond showrunners, but honestly, I really believe if someone were to ask me what is the, I don't say the one thing that's sort of an absolute, but among the things that infuriate me, and very seriously, is seeing, with respect to white dudes, you know, a white dude coming out of like Sundance with an okay film and getting handed a multi-tens of million-dollar franchise. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you don't see it with women. You don't see it with people of color. And part of it, obviously, as a person of color, that's my focus. But as a showrunner, just to bring it back around to television, you know, you look at the numbers of women who are not directing. And just by demographic, you know, I want to be careful because I don't want, you know, I can just see how this is going to get parsed.
You can see the column.
But like, you know what? Based on the conversation about ability, you know, by demographic, women should be just tripping into jobs in TV. If there are 400 some scripted shows and how many hours and quality out there. So there's those levels of things that infuriate. I mean, look, with respect to talking about people who fail up or, you know, my career, without being self-effacing, it was a lot of failures until the point I sort of embraced the fact that most people aren't interested in what I'm doing. but there was a point in you know, the mid-2000s where it was like, well, nobody likes this stuff anyway, so let me just do a bunch of stuff that really entertains
you.
Me and that I feel really, as you say, amazingly passionate about. And it was very, I don't think ironic because it's sort of a truth. You know, I can't say I planned this
right.
last third of my career, but there were a lot of things where it was like, I'm just doing this because I love it. And then people were like, oh my God, that's really, really interesting. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but it's the same crap I've been doing. It's just I'm doing it with maybe a little bit more passion.
But I think also to take it away from the injustice of the whole thing, in fact, inevitably, if you get anywhere in this game, it's usually because you've got one thing that you're known for and you do maybe quite well.
Sure.
And then you become the go-to person for that particular kind of job, and then you do more and more of it, and of course you start to think, why can't I do a superhero movie? But
yes.
You know, that's just the way up the ladder, and then you have to work about spreading it. It is very thrilling when you're asked to do something different. I mean, I was asked to do School of Rock, which seemed about as unlikely as anything you could imagine. And then, of course, it was thrilling when the offer came through. I loved the movie anyway, but it's partly because you just think, who in the world would think I would be the guy to go to for School of Rock? But I think that's a battle for any screenwriter, any actor who has got anywhere, is you get there by being kind of known for one sort of thing. And then you and your agent and everyone else has to try and stretch it out.
Well, but I don't know that you can separate all this from the injustice of it all, because I do think that there is a level where there are people who would look, I can say personally, there are people, yes, who will look at me now and say, we'd love you to do something. And I'm not trying to pick on any particular pick a franchise. And it's not that, and it's not this. And there's certainly mornings where I wake up and go, hey, you know what? I'm doing American Crime. I'm doing these small things. I'm doing things that I love and have an immense amount of control over. Why walk into the $200 million franchise where you know that you're going to have to put up with things where you agree or disagree that are going to be very hard? But there are other days where I wake up and I go, I got kids who are 12 and 16. They deserve to see, even if it's a little bit of my perspective injected in here in some, you know, mild indoctrination, you know, I want to do that. So I vacillate, but I would disagree. I think there is a level where there are people who are not looking at some folks at this table and saying, you know, we want to give you Star Trek. Jesus, why would we, you know, but she does these small
things. They know
feminist
I just
things.
Do a thing about all female tribbles. It would just be.
But I gotta tell you, the little bits of, again,
I can see that.
Yeah. With everybody audience for
here
all
with their
things.
Shows, everybody has an opportunity to just, broad audiences come to it, but there are little spaces where we can inject. And I think that movies, and again, I'm not trying to make it about movies, but they're not there, and people aren't looking,
absolutely.
And they're not thinking necessarily, well, if you can do that, you can do that.
But there's also that thing, the attitude that I think is very corporate, which is, well, we have a woman directing a film of our slate of 30, and we have, you know, John Ridley, he's doing this show that's very topical, so we're covered. You know, how many times have I heard, like, oh, you're doing that lady movie, you know, we've got that one, you know, that one.
Or have you gotten the one where your agent goes to put you up for a job and they say, we already have a woman.
Oh, yeah.
Still today.
Yes. And that's the problem with bringing up the Oscars thing and that whole controversy. The problem is it starts to go into this token culture and it starts to, see, the thing that I think is cool about going into, like, I think that's the advantage that, wow, we're gonna, like, you know what? We have been telling the same story seven times, but not from these different perspectives, not from these different points of views. That's where it's gonna be really exciting. That's where it's gonna be really original to tell those same stories, but with that whole different spin that people don't even know about yet. And if you go into it with that kind of energy, but right now it starts to feel to me like, oh, this is homework. We're gonna look bad.
Let's
just do, make it a transfer, whatever it is, and just really like tick that box off.
One of the great things too about what I love about working in television, I would never leave, is it's such a collaborative medium, and the writing room is essential.
Yeah.
And that's where you're getting your different perspectives. Mm-hmm. So I bring to the room a certain experience in life.
Sure.
But I make sure my staff is very diverse in terms of gender and race and background. That's my first question, when I'm sure it is with y'all as well, when you meet
There's
a writer.
There's no one else in my writing room.
But you're worldly. You got
it's me and a cup of coffee.
All right, I want to talk about the casting process, and particularly about your sort of your best stories of approaching talent, particularly when the characters themselves aren't necessarily the likable character. I mean, certainly with OJ, I mean, you had to approach a bunch of people who not only are their real life people that they'll have to sort of live up to, but there are some dark characters. Are there stories that you can share with us?
For one, casting with Ryan Murphy as your partner is unlike anything I've ever experienced, uh-huh. because he has so. For one, so many actors really want to work with him and know that he does right by them. But then also, he's able to get, you know, the studio and the network to pay for all of them. Uh-huh. Like, usually you get like, oh, you got that one great person. You're good.
Yep.
Now just cast the rest of the show.
Like, John Travolta, we're done.
We were able to have a level of ambition that, honestly, I could not believe. Or we kept thinking, at some point, they're going to be like, that's enough. With the first on the call sheet types.
Yep.
Right.
But so that was an incredible thing.
What about convincing these people?
But it did take some convincing. You know, the thing that I thought was interesting, I mean, it certainly took a lot of convincing of Travolta to come back to TV.
Yep.
After 30 years. And so there was a lot of, I'd had a long relationship with him, and mm-hmm. that helped. So he trusted me. And he was a huge fan of Ryan's. But it was a long courtship. It was a long process of him finding peace with coming back to television,
right.
and doing so with subject matter that we knew was provocative,
sure.
and could be controversial.
What about Cuba? I mean, you're convincing someone to take on the role of O.J. Simpson. That is loaded beyond belief.
It was, and I think Cuba was very game because there are qualities about Cuba that just made him so right, and that likability and that the feeling of that charisma and unknowability, all of those qualities, I think he was really raring to go. The character who was interesting and hard to cast, actually, was Darden.
I was going to say.
Because there were a lot of black dudes who were just like, no way.
Yeah.
I'm not playing that guy.
Huh.
Yeah.
No way. Mm. Like, I hate him. I'm not going to play him. You know? Huh. Not to mention the fact that there were also guys who, even if they were willing to play him, we knew that, you know, Johnny Cochran and Courtney, who would have to sort of, you know, eat Darden for breakfast, yeah. ultimately. Like, he outshined him. Yeah. He's one of the most accomplished and showman-like litigators out there. Like, it doesn't get better than Johnny Cochran.
Nope.
And you had to get somebody who could be, on the one hand, charismatic and sexy enough that you were rooting for him overall and that you really cared about him, but on the other hand, somebody who could let himself be bowled over.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of actors would walk in and they just couldn't do it. Mm. They were so charismatic mm-hmm. and alpha that they couldn't be the guy who got overwhelmed, or they were so sort of beta that they couldn't be the guy that you rooted for. And with Sterling, when we finally started to watch his audition over and over again, it actually took me a while. I had to go and look at his other work because I was like, God, he's so great, but is he sexy enough? Mm-hmm. And then I go and I look at all of the other work and I realize this is a show he's put on. He's come in with the glasses and the bottled rage, and he's pretending to be this guy. He's acting.
he's acting.
He is sexy, charismatic.
Oh, my God, that look in the hallway in the hotel withering.
He is a hottie.
Yes.
And I had no idea, based on his audition, that he was that guy until we went and looked at all the other work, and we were like, okay, we have him. But there were guys who were just like, no way. Mm-hmm. Such a darn.
Were there any other characters that you found were particularly hard to cast for any of those reasons?
I don't think that's the problem. I think in England, in Britain, you come up against a lot of snobbery about actors. And if they've been in a soap opera, if they've been in this, if they've been in that, oh, no, we don't want to have that. And they're perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to go to war, because I've been an actor and I know you take the best of what's on offer. You don't, you know, rather than stay home, you take what you're offered. And I really have had to fight over that. And one story, which actually we were talking about before, which gave me a tremendous insight, was I was doing a contemporary story and there was one character, a policeman, and I wanted to cast an actor who was black. Mm-hmm. And I got all... I was just a fan of his. There was no other reason. And I got all these people saying, why does the character have to be black? What's the point? Why are you making him black? I said, he doesn't have to be black. I like this guy's work. And I mean, I won in the end. Mm-hmm. But you get such a window on what people are up against.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. For me, casting Jessica Jones was always going to be a huge challenge. And the reason for that, amongst other things, is... She's got to be, you got to believe she can kick ass, you know, so some teeny little thing with, you know, arms this thin are just not, you know, it's not going to do it. But, and she also has to be a great dramatic actress. But the hardest thing was she also has to be able to deliver a dry line. And so that combination is very, there's a lot of actors and actresses who, their dramatic chops are fantastic. But man, the comedy goes to die with that person. You know? You know, that's why Ritter was always very close to the top of the list, because I knew she could at least deliver a dry line. And then I saw her run in Breaking Bad. I'm like, oh, okay. She's a dramatic actress too. She's phenomenal. And so there really are very, very few people who could have played that role.
Yeah.
None, I think, other than
And for leading players, you need that kind of layered performer who can be very funny now and 2 minutes later break your heart. Right. And they're just, you know, a lot of them can't do that.
Well, the other one was David Tennant, actually, who also had that same balance of being able to be charming and likable, but also heinous and heartbreaking and funny. You know, I mean, it was
But there are actors, I assume, who are nervous about playing the heinous. And I imagine there are actors who sort of sit there and think, I don't know. I don't want to live in this space, or B, I don't want to be hated by an audience.
We've all come into contact with that.
Yeah.
Sure.
It's weird because you try and just not ever have that be part of the conversation. And honestly, one of the things that I do is and I think everybody here probably does, when you cast, in person at least, you ask some questions, you start to get to know them a little bit.
What did you ask Rami? I mean, Rami was a relative unknown.
I mean, he was shaking. I mean, he literally said the script breeds anxiety. And then, you know, and then he was so, like, just all, like, looking around. I mean, it was nerve-wracking. And I was like, I don't know, is he going to get through this audition? And then he did and by that point, we had seen maybe 100 guys. Uh-huh. And it was not right. Uh-huh. And it was the Fuck Society speech, and it felt didactic, and I was like, this is terrible. I've written, we gotta call USA, cancel this. This is not good. And then when Rami did it, at the beginning, I was like, I don't know where this audition's gonna go. He was a nervous wreck, but then he just did it. And I don't know if that was part of the character. He probably psyched me out.
That's the lesson learned from everybody here.
Actors can act.
But the thing that Rami told me is, like, he loved all the jagged edges of this character. You know, the other thing is, especially with TV, in particular with TV, you don't want to cast an asshole. As good as they might be, if they're an asshole, I really do not want to work with
and
that person.
And every single person at this table has cast an asshole at one point.
And then you have to live with that.
Cast an asshole, some of them turn into
us. That's true, too.
No, I'm sure we all do, very deep vetting with everyone. I will call on anyone in the PA, the star, what's that?
Not deep enough.
Yes.
Some will still get through the nets.
I have no doubt.
Because with a movie, maybe you get through it, but on TV,
you've got years or something.
Yeah, so it is having that conversation and seeing where... But if you start picking up the signal that, they're worrying about how they look and the likability and all that, then
it's done.
It's over.
I remember there was it's probably apocryphal, but there was a story that was told that Stephen Bochco had a death scene for each of his characters on all of his shows. And if one of the actors started to really become problematic in a way that was destructive to the show, he just called them up and, like, pull it out of his side and hand it to them and say, read that.
Brilliant.
And if they, you know, accepted it, then they... And I've always thought about that, which is, you know, life is too short. Life is too short to live in that world.
It's hard, you know, the schedule, the amount of work, It's a hard job. Yeah. I mean, I know, you know, we're lucky to be doing it and all that.
Right.
But nevertheless,
right.
It's a nightmare.
It's a hard job that you should wear lightly. Mm-hmm. It's a hard job that we are all sometimes prone to take way too seriously and think that we are way more important than we really are. And I feel like it's that balance of we're all in the service of the show or the message, but ultimately, it's fake surgery. It's not real brain surgery. Like, one is going to, you know, people will care if there's no show next week, but you have to have a sense of humor about it and yourself.
Yeah. Speaking of sense of humor about things, I mean, with Unreal, you've tackled the sort of unscripted industry, and I imagine you have heard from many people within that industry, some who think it is wonderful and hilarious and some who are not so pleased with the depiction.
Yeah.
What are the more entertaining conversations
that you've had? I mean, the ultimate was getting a Twitter about us from the host of The Bachelor. That was like, I hear this show is trash, and da da da. You know, he just basically just said something negative, and I was just like, he noticed that. I felt like, you know, the popular kid had noticed the nerd over on, you know, Lifetime. I was like, I was thrilled. No, I mean, the thing that I hear the most is from people who work in reality who say it's dead on. And that's chilling.
Yeah, I would think so.
People who say that the behind the scenes just feels real to them and that they are kind of, it's sort of about time that people who watch scripted realize that it's not scripted, you know, watch unscripted realize that it's not unscripted.
Yeah.
And that we're taking people who are not performers and subjecting them to a process whereby they fall into storylines and then we abandon them.
What are the more chilling ones?
Then they go back to their hometowns.
But what are the sort of more chilling ones where you realize, this is actually real because I've heard from people now who have,
well,
in
a lot
fact
of the things
it.
On the first season, you know, and I'm not as involved in the second season, so I can't really speak to that. But in the first season, they were stories that we had either heard firsthand or, you know, confirmed things that really happened.
Like
so,
what? What are the things you guys hear no to, the things that you just can't do on these shows? You're laughing because you clearly have, you've tried.
Not to sound like a shill, ABC's been really good. The biggest issue that we had very early on was that I wanted to turn in the scripts without act breaks. Uh-huh. And it wasn't like, hey, we're gonna then put it on your network and you're not gonna have any commercial space. They understood that we were gonna cut it up, but that we just wanted to turn in the script as a piece. And early on, they really, everything else that we threw at them, they were, we can figure this out, it's good. Obviously, the FCC things that we couldn't do, we understood that we couldn't do. That was the one thing. And then remarkably, after about the third episode, they just embraced it because it was such a modular show. Mm. Yeah, I mean, we don't throw things that we know we're not going to get away with. We don't waste anybody's time with things that we just know we can't put on broadcast. But the mandate was to talk about things that if you were seeing it in a streaming space, you may not know that this was necessarily ABC or, you know, CBS with The Good Wife or any other of the outlets where there is maybe a little bit more latitude baked into the system.
It's funny that you bring up the act breaks, because I don't do that either.
Yeah.
And I don't, because in the room, we don't even, you know how you're supposed to write for an act out?
Yeah.
You know? Definitely don't do that. And I hate that. And then, like, if we get a note from, you know, the network, okay, we really think the act break should be here. I'm like, fine, yeah, whatever.
Yes. You can see
I'm curious from a content perspective. But, I mean, we had Kenya Barris the other day who talked about the fact that there were images that he wanted to be able to, you know, the Twin Towers image, the Sandy Hook image. These are images that could not be used in the show. Mm-hmm.
Here's what I do. Just, I say fuck all the time.
Yeah. Yep.
It's never going to air like that.
Yep.
We had you know, a sex scene that the network did talk to me about.
Did it get on or not?
It did get on. I mean, and my argument, because it was between two men.
Oh, yes.
And it was pretty graphic.
Yes.
Yeah, it was good.
And, yes, it was indeed that. Uh-huh.
And my argument to them would be, you know, if this was between a man and a woman, would be be having this conversation. Yeah. And that was basically...
good enough.
That was the end of that conversation.
Huh. I don't understand the thing about the act breaks, though, because often when you edit the show, the
you
scenes change order and
yeah.
everything.
Yeah. Sure.
So it's completely meaningless to say where yeah. they're going to be.
Yeah.
We didn't have that at ITV at all, actually. They would say it's got to be approximately so many minutes in.
Yeah.
And then within three or four scenes, they didn't mind. You just... yeah. chose the best break.
But they never ask you to act right no. toward an actor.
That's what I mean. There's always this, you know, in some television shows, there's this big dun-dun-dun.
I love the sting you know, at the end.
And the dolly end.
Yeah.
And...
it's always that.
Yeah.
I see.
The beauty of working at Netflix is they're, you don't have those limits.
Sure. Mm.
But I also work... and I also work with Marvel, and
there are
Marvel
many.
Has a brand.
Yes.
And their brand is generally PG-13.
Yes.
They've kind of led us to go to PG-16.
So what are the things that you wanted to?
Three-year differential.
Yeah, I don't know what...
But also, they just did Deadpool. Isn't that like...
it's film, and it's a different... it's also Fox versus...
got it.
Marvel has...
What are the things
so
that...
So no F-bombs. You know, and if anyone was going to say fuck, it would be Jessica Jones.
Yeah.
I mean, I just sometimes like, please, let me just put one. And never. But what was funny is that people have said, she didn't say fuck. I could have sworn she did.
Yeah.
Because Ritter can deliver.
Because it's right
fuck
for her
with
to
her
hear
face.
It.
Yeah. She can just, like, her look says it. She could be saying potato. And the other thing is there's sex to some degree. There was not really any nudity.
Yep.
But then people go, you're saying, it was very much like what you're talking about, the rape in Downton Abbey. People are saying, there was no nudity? Wait a minute, that was some really graphic sense. Like, no, not never. Any.
Huh.
So it was very, it's all about the attitude and about how it's shot and how it's acted with raw lust versus, you know, oh, there's a side boob. Or, you know,
again, it's acting. I mean, it's truly great acting.
It's amazing. One thing we can't do, I'll just say this, like on ABC, one thing I discovered is you can't say asshole. But you can say ass in any other combination of words.
Yes.
So we've, on this other thing we're doing, we have just this litany of ass fill in the blank.
And it's
anything at all, ass can, ass hat, ass, you know, just anything. And it's just fun because they can't really, it's like they can't stop you now. It's like this rush
well,
towards the exit.
You guys dropped the biggest, one of my favorite F-bombs of all time.
Yeah, we got the MF-bomb.
The MF-bomb.
Yeah, we would get our letters.
Which one?
We would get in when Johnny comes onto the case.
Yeah.
Marsh is sitting outside.
And it's this big, long...
receives in the paper at the end of an episode and drops the MF-bomb.
Yeah.
But you get the letters.
We got the emails from standard practices about language, about the N-word, obviously.
I can imagine why
we're like,
does that.
It's essential to our show. It's an essential part of the show. It's not gratuitous. It's got to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And ultimately, you know, FX was very supportive of it and never, and they sort of stood behind us. I mean, if we found that we had stuff that didn't matter, we'd be like, fine, that doesn't matter. Let's just get rid of it.
Yeah.
But the ones that mattered, we fought for, and FX backed us on it. But we did get quite a few, very entertaining.
If standard practices came to me, and again, we had F-bombs everywhere, all sorts of things. They would say, you can't say this on air. And I'll say, okay, we'll drop the audio out. Because I knew online we would,
be
you know, on iTunes,
it.
We'll have it. And eventually they caught on that I was just like, okay, fine, we'll drop the audio out. In fact, it just happened last week. And they were like, oh, and then they wound up just starting to be more lenient because they knew I would just drop the audio.
Anyway.
And then throughout the episode, they'd have all these audio dropouts. but I mean, I think to me, it's like rather than pussyfooting around what people would actually say. I mean, we had a Hispanic guy say the N-word, and that was a big deal. Yeah. But I was like, but they... people say that. People do that. That's life. Mm-hmm. That's
it's we're reality. We're not
and it goes back to how do you land that? Make sure that scene feels authentic and that's, you know, true to life. But it's like I don't think language for me. It's such a weird thing that's still a hot topic issue that we have.
I mean, I can saw a guy's arm off and have the blood.
That's what I'm saying.
Up, but I can't
that's
say the word.
That's what I'm
fuck.
Saying. It's so bizarre.
Yeah. I want to talk about expectations because several of you have shows that had these very big first seasons, and now you have to sort of deliver again, and what that process is. All right, the look.
Thanks, Lacey. I'm like now I'm.
You're not feeling that at all. But yeah, I mean that you certainly have that. And you're now taking on a very different subject matter with Katrina. And I'm curious sort of how you sort of make that decision and do you have fears about the decision now that you've seen how OJ landed and what is that sort of process?
Well, Well, I mean, of course, for us, you know, especially, you know, my producing partner, Brad Simpson, and I, it was our first rodeo. It's our first time making television.
Doesn't
and
always then, work this way.
And we, well, that's right, it doesn't. And we partnered, you know, we had wonderful writers in Scott and Larry, and then we partnered with Ryan, who just has incredibly great instincts and reach. And so we had this really very unlikely first go. Mm-hmm. And OJ is a singular case that is unlike anything else. It's not like there's a bunch of other stories just like that. And so that's, I think that was part of why we decided for our second season. We wanted to do something very different. Actually, somebody said this to me, which I really liked the idea of a lot, which is that what each of these seasons would be is a crime in which the America that we think of ourselves as or want to see ourselves as and the America we see in the mirror at that moment in time are at odds.
What are you doing for the second series?
Hurricane Katrina. You know, a series of crimes which begin with how it happened that this city was so vulnerable and the people who were left behind were so vulnerable. And we wanted to go to something very different and very bold, but kind of keep that thematic focus on this sort of portrait of America as seen through these sort of watershed moments that are crimes defined one way or the other.
I think that's sort of gonna, that seems to me the way to approach a second season after a first one is done very well is to not try to imitate it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's that was seems my thinking going into season two is I'm never going to have Kilgrave and David Tennant again. That like right. That's oops. So why try to get another fabulous British actor and a mind reader? To completely reinvent.
Well, for exactly that reason, when we decided to have a go at doing a period drama, which the current thinking at that time was that period drama was dead. Mm. Everyone thought Peter Finch was mad to be doing it. And we deliberately started it in 1912 because if it did have any legs, it meant the second series would be in the First World War and the third series would be at the beginning of the 20s. So they were all three completely distinct. But, you know, having said that, at the end of the first series is a scene when the war is announced, which could be the last scene if it was never recommissioned. Mm-hmm. Because the one thing people forget is that you don't know it's been a success until all the filming is over and the editing is over and everything. You're just like a Spartan mother exposing your child on Mount Taygetus to see if it can sustain itself in the weather.
And I thought the same thing. That's amazing.
All right, so which of the characters that you guys have on these shows, who do you sort of most identify with?
I go with Elliot. I mean...
In what ways?
I mean, in every way. I mean, it's a pretty much a thinly veiled... I mean, that's a thinly veiled version of myself. But, like, you know, obviously glamorized because I'm not as handsome as Rami Malek. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot of, you know, write what you know. I wrote what I knew because a lot of the details of his life and the loneliness and all that were some, you know, issues that I've dealt with, for, you know, basically my whole life. I know, poor me.
Marty, what about you? I mean, you've got all these different women in across your shows. Are there, whether it's the whole composite of them or are there pieces of these characters, who do you sort of see yourself
I was going to say Mary, who went off the roof.
The suicide episode.
No, I think that as we've talked about the whole time, there's such big pieces of my experience, and in the case of Unreal, like Sarah and my experience and our experience working together that really came out in that first season. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for me, it's really become, like, the road narrows. It's like there has got to be some blood on the page or it's just not interesting to me anymore. Yeah. So read into that what you will.
Okay.
I have to identify with Maggie Smith. Because I love people who know who they are and don't have any trouble with it, you know, and don't think, oh, what did that sound like? And I must unsay that quickly. She doesn't have any of that. And so I suppose, but of course the other thing is they're all your babies, you know.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
You make them all. And you kind of love them all, really.
But the question wasn't about who you liked the most. It was who you most identified with. And perhaps those are the ones you like the least. Kind
of, I think there are bits of us in all the characters we write, and particularly as we put them into predicaments where we have often lived through something fairly similar. Yeah, I mean, I think you love them all. They're your babies.
I think I identify with each character as I'm writing it. Mm-hmm. You know, and so there's, and as we're creating it, I'm you know,
in it.
Injecting myself into their psyche. And so I can relate to Hogarth's ambition and Trisha's nobility or attempt to be, and, you know, Jessica's misanthropy and, you know, it's in Malcolm's naivete. You know, there's at any one time I'm identifying with each. So it is true that there's pieces of us in every character, and that's what keeps them honest, is if you're just writing some person, you know, without throwing yourself into
the consciousness. Well, that's going back to your formulaic thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Sure. So what are the shows that inspired you as storytellers? I mean, whether it was as children, whether it was sort of later, more recently.
I mean, Hill Street. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
I was just talking about Botchko. Like, I went back and watched Hill Street because for a project that I was doing. And, God, that pilot is incredible. I was thinking about just some of the shows that I watched when I was younger. You know, those were the unicorns. Those were the exceptions, the shows that were really remarkable. And when you go back and watch some of those, they really... But the whole Botchko camp, you know, NYPD Blue was so, you know, progressive for its time and envelope pushing. And, you know, just... I also want to do a police... drama at some point in my spare time.
Yeah, David, you get a lot of that. Just add a seventh show to your,
David Kelly was in those early years with Picket Fences and L.A. Law. Certainly, that was when I think I sort of became aware that TV was actually written, that was a job, you know, and Winnie Holzman, my so-called. That is 18 hours of perfect
perfection.
Mad Men was pretty perfect for me, actually. Yeah. I just loved it. It didn't inspire me to do it because I didn't start watching it until late. I'd sort of missed it. And a friend of mine said, "You're completely mad and I'm giving you the first series for your birthday." And then I was absolutely hooked. I thought it was stylistically, it was so sort of chic at the same time as everything else. And I loved West Wing and I loved The Good One. I mean, I think American television has been fantastically strong over the last decade, really.
I have to say Twin Peaks because it was like it was a mystery. It wasn't the same episode every week. It was definitely a continuation. And I mean, as a kid, I don't remember having that feeling with any other show where I was like, wait a minute, I'm essentially just watching a really, really long movie by a feature filmmaker, you know, who I happen to really love. And the mystery about it. Like, there was just something about drawing out this mystery. On that note, it's Twilight Zone was also amazing.
Yeah.
Because it just made you, like, kind of lean into the TV.
Sure.
You know, as you're watching, it's the very definition of I want to know what happens next. Which that part of it excited me.
Well, I would say The West Wing and most, I'm going to say most of Sorkin's gender politics are pretty retrograde. I have a real problem with his gender stuff.
Really? But other than that, the shows were terrific.
No, he's brilliant. He's brilliant. You, By the way, I went on a rant about this to a friend. Just, I have a whole thing about
the newsroom.
I mean, a whole thing. I do the impressions and everything. And I did this for my friend because she had mentioned that she knows him, and maybe you know, we could go to dinner. And and I went through this whole thing, and at the end she went, "Oh my God, he'd love you." Which is a scene out of The Newsroom.
Yep.
But what you were saying about Twin Peaks, the great thing about that show is it was both. Those characters were so fascinating and heartbreaking.
That's the thing. I want both. There are sometimes shows where I do like the characters, but man, after like 40 times of seeing them do the same thing, and I'm like, but maybe they're like breaking up with the person instead of dating them.
It's not so much like, actually, for me. It's kind of being involved with their ongoing narrative, wanting to know how it turns out. I mean, my favorite character can be the villain. It isn't, I don't need to like them.
Right.
But I need to want to know what happens to them next.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
All right, we're going to end with what I hope is a fun last question. If each of you were to turn the cameras on yourselves and do an autobiographical series, what would be the working title?
I already did it, Mr. Robot. Out.
You got it.
I'd call mine uphill.
Right.
I was 50 before anything happened. The theme, burying failure, is part of every successful career. I mean, that you make it look as if it's, you know, those
right.
yeah. screen biographies when everyone was adorable and every film you made was so happy. But in fact, you just bury the dark stuff, which I think can be rather misleading, actually.
Sure, sure.
Possibly a musical.
Yeah?
Yeah, like a dance movie.
What would it be?
A musical?
A musical.
Oh, a musical.
The content would be about failure. So I've gotten fired more than all of you put together, no doubt. And just, you know, I think if I were a white dude, I'd probably have failed a fraction as many times.
Like you the longest. As good. You wouldn't have been tested by those failures.
Yes. Oh, I have been seriously tested. So, but, you know, it's also, I'm grateful for it because mm-hmm. it's shaped everything about my life and I'm pretty happy.
All right, Marti, what's your show about?
I mean, I'm a little bit like Sam. It's on TV. It's called Your Girlfriend's Guide to Divorce. I mean, that's pretty ripped from the headlines.
That's your world.
Yeah.
Well, thank you guys. Oh, we got away without yeah. doing this, yeah. Nina. Yeah.
I'd probably go with there's got to be a pony in here somewhere.
I love it. I would put that on there.
I would watch that.
That's a good one.
Done. Sold.
Absolutely.
On that note, thank you guys all for being a part of this. It's a great conversation.
Really great question.
Thank you for watching.
Thank you so much for watching. Be sure to subscribe.
Make sure you subscribe to watch more videos
on The Hollywood Reporter.
The Hollywood Reporter.
Peace. Mwah!